Performance is waiting for you. Take your pick of the best side-by-side sports machines the industry has by Polaris. Dominate the trails in a 50-inch RZR 800 or 570, or bring your friends along in a 4-seat RZR 4 or XP4. Or you can slide behind the wheel of the undisputed king of high-performance RZR XP900. Every RZR is built to deliver the ultimate combination of power, suspension, and agility. That's razor-sharp performance waiting for you at Perkins Tire and Polaris, Highway 90, Pascagoula.
ATVs and side-by-side vehicles can be hazardous to operate. Polaris adult models are for riders age 16 and older. Always wear a helmet and be sure to take a training course. Polaris ATVs and side-by-side vehicles are not intended for on-road use.
For a relaxed dining experience that's unmatched anywhere on the Gulf Coast, it's Scranton's Restaurant. Scranton's Restaurant in downtown Pascagoula is located in the former Central Fire Station and City Hall, offering a picturesque historical setting with a one-of-a-kind feel. At Scranton's, you'll find a unique menu with a true Southern flair, featuring steaks, seafood, and chicken. Open for lunch and dinner Monday through Friday with daily specials. Catering services available on and off the premises. Scranton's is also a great location for your reception with private and banquet rooms on site. Scranton's Restaurant, 623 Delmas Avenue in downtown Pascagoula. Phone 228-769-1900 or log on to scrantons.com.
O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home has been serving the families of Jackson County since 1943. Since then, O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home has maintained a progressive approach in adjusting to the changes in our community. O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home is a full-service funeral home serving all denominations and customs and providing quality service to generations of families. O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home is prepared to handle any service or request your family may have with openness and understanding. All pre-needs or pre-arrangements can be transferred to O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home without any charge. A proud supporter of all of our area high schools. O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home is located on Telephone Road in Pascagoula and the only funeral home in Goshen on Ladner Road. Call 762-4311 for your pre-needs or any other questions you may have. We're here to answer at 762-4311.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. Another Tuesday has come and gone. Yes, we're in the building. And today, I have a special guest with me, Mitch Ellerby, running for state representative. A seat that he once used to hold. So you're talking about a guy of experience, a man that knows about the job. Why? Because he did it before. As they say, been there, done that, did that. Well, this is the man that has been there, done that. He's used to being up there in the trenches. He's used to being in the ring fighting with these bears. That's what he's done before. And he did a great job at it. He held his seat down for 8 years. And he's running for it again. The governor called for a special election. And the man put his name in the hat and said he's the man. So before we get into him, we got, of course, do your commercial breaks. Real Talk is brought to you by Fred Price, Fred Price Junior Insurance. Fred Price Junior Insurance, they can meet all your auto, health, home insurance need. You can contact Fred Price Junior at 497-2757. They're located in the old Jerry Lee Shopping Center in Goche, Mississippi. And again, they got home, owners, life, any type of insurance. He's an independent agent. He can put you with anybody. That's his specialty. That's what makes him better than the next. So he's been in business since 1988. So call Mr. Price at Fred Price Junior Insurance Agency at, of course, 228-497-2757. And, of course, this show is brought to you by San Miguel Azteca. San Miguel, located in Moss Point, Mississippi. Azteca is located in Goche, Mississippi. Of course, you go down there, like I tell you guys every week. My favorite is the fish tacos, I love them. And hot wings, I love them. You go there from 2 to 6 every evening. That's the happy hour. You get everything for a nice discounted price. That's what I love. So I go there every day as often as I can. And I did say I went every day because I did. 2 weeks ago, I went there every day. And I got my special. So go to Aztecas. You can watch. All they got big screen, 6 big screen TVs everywhere. The place is nice. I love it. I go there all the time, man. Good friendly service. Go down there, get you eat on, sit there, watch the game. Now football season is back in. We love this, and that's what I do. I was even there last night, watched a little football. All right. Of course, I'm your host, Emmanuel, and I'm joined here by my co-host, Tyrone. He's in the building tonight. And, of course, the man of the hour, Mr. Mitch Ellaby.
Good evening.
How you doing, sir?
Sir, I've never felt better. Thank you for inviting me to your show. And I'd like to thank you and your staff and also your listening audience to hear me out tonight.
That's what's up. Now, I looked at your credentials, man. And when I looked at it, I had to have like three pages. You're a man of many, many avenues. From the Vietnam War days, you fought for your country. You put your life on the line. You had to work on helicopters that were shot down. You was the man. And I see you support the veteran cause a lot.
Yes.
Being that you was one, or still are.
I am a veteran.
Yeah, once you're a veteran, you sound like my daddy. Once you're a veteran, you're always a veteran. And, of course, Tyrone, he's a veteran, too. He was a Marine. He did 3 tours in Iraq over there. So.
And I'd like to thank him for his service and your father and all other veterans out there for their service that they've rendered to their country.
That's what's up. And I see your education, your background here from going to Jackson State, degreed. You went to
Benedict College in Columbia, South Carolina.
All right.
And it was amazing. At first, I wasn't going to college. And then my mother insisted, like all parents do. Mm-hmm. And so I'm glad I did. And my first 2 years there, I played around. And then when I got drafted, Uncle Sam sent me this fine letter saying, greetings, your friends and neighbor have selected you. And the process started from there. And I wanted to fly the helicopters. I always fantasy with flying. But one thing, I wore glasses. Uh-huh. So my next alternative was to work on them. Uh-huh. So I wanted to be the best helicopter mechanic they got. And I went from Fort Jackson to Fort Rucker, Alabama, Fort Rucker, Alabama, up to Fort Bragg, where my company was formed. And then I got my assignments to go to Vietnam. And did I cry? Yes, I did. I didn't want to leave home, didn't want to leave my country. But when I got to Vietnam, I made up my mind and promised the good Lord that if he get me back home safely, I would make something out myself. And I came back from Vietnam, and I finished up college, got my degree, and started my work career.
Okay, that's great. And make somebody yourself, you did, because your legislative experiences, let's see, you came back from Vietnam in what year?
I got back from Vietnam in 1968 and went back and finished college. And matter of fact, I started my first job, on-the-job training program at a local television station in Columbia, South Carolina, WIS-TV, mm-hmm. which was affiliated with WLOX
right.
down in Biloxi. And they had several other stations, but I wanted to advance to sales, but I learned all of the operations, a cameraman, audio technician, video technician, and then I became a director. And we started our first awareness show there at the television station. But time moves on, and I got the opportunity to go work with Sears.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I got my management training through Sears in Orlando, Florida. And then I came to Mississippi. And it's like everybody that comes to Mississippi, where are we going and who is this here? But once I got here, I liked Mississippi. It's been good for me. It's been good for my family.
Right. Now, I was looking at your business experience. And you're speaking of being a manager, learning your managerial skills at Sears. How did that apply into you being able to balance and manage budgets and things that you guys sat down and do and did while you was in a state legislator?
When I was a division manager, you are taught how to deal with people. You're taught how to deal with budget and money and how to buy and combos. When you buy merchandise, it's like everything else. You got to go back and look at your previous sales. This helped me in the legislature because when you're dealing with budget, you're dealing with different groups, organizations within the state that have their demands for money, and you have to sit down and prioritize what's most important to the people. Mm-hmm. Just like when you're trying to make a profit. But when you're dealing with people and their affairs, it's a little bit of different avenue that you have to travel. But my management experience helped me out there with that and teaching my people skills. I've also done longshoreman work. I worked mm-hmm. with Head Start. And it was just a golden opportunity. And when you have these opportunities, you have to put all these together. And when you sat down with 122, 120, one other men, you make 122, and women, you have to either become very good at what you do or you sit on the sideline.
Right. And I was speaking a little bit about your business experience. I see you worked with the city of Morris Point, building code inspector, code enforcement, consultant, commissioner. You helped, I guess, start up the power generation plant at at chemicals and petroleum refineries. That was in U.S. as well as Canada.
Right.
Division manager at Sears. I mean, you've done a lot of things here.
Well, because I wanted to. I didn't let, my theory is like my grandmother always told me, a rat is a pretty poor rat when he only have one hole to crawl in and out of. Because if the kitty cat has his paw over one hole, he's going to eat you. So you learn to put all your skills together, get out here, believe in yourself, believe in God, and move forward. Because if one job not what you can do, go to the next one. And that's why you see my resume as it is, because when I left Chevron, I learned a lot there, met a lot of interesting people there. But there's a life after Chevron.
Right, and you retired from there.
And I retired from there. So I started traveling, doing startup commissioning work. My first job was in Chicago. Then I worked from there to a nuke plant. And I worked in Dixon, Illinois, Lake Charles, Louisiana, New York, Linden, New Jersey.
So basically, you're a hardworking man that believes in sticking with it. Whatever you start, you stick with
it. I finish it up.
I see you've been married for 40 years. You stuck with her too, huh?
I stuck with her. She's been a wonderful woman to me. A lot of people don't believe that I'm married, but my wife and I have a good working relationship. And we work together. She has been my backbone and my supporter. And because when people can say what they want to say, but when I lost my mom, my wife has always been important to me as my mother.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they say behind every good man is a good woman, huh?
You can bet your sweet bippy is true.
And I see you've been appointed to Selective Service Board Committee member, former Jackson County Port Authority Commissioner, former Tidelands and Wetlands Commissioner, Habitat for Humanity Board Member. I mean, you've been just about on everything around here that the coast can offer.
Yes.
As well as already had this position before that you're reapplying for. You're rerunning for a position that you already know well. You held it down for 8 years, and you're trying to get this message out to the community. And before I let you go, I want to ask you and hit on what would be your main priority? You're prioritizing.
Well, when I start prioritizing, my main thing is that I'm committed to work with city and county government to help bring prosperity to the citizens of District 110. When I say that, I'm talking about Pascagoula, Moss Point, Gulchay, Ocean Spring, the whole coastal as well as the state, and help improve our educational system, support existing business, and bring new business and industry and jobs to our area. We have to go and knock on doors. We must go knock on doors because investors are willing to come if we ask.
Right.
If you ask not, get not.
Right. And that's what I was going to ask you, because, you know, I had a guy here a couple months ago that was running for mayor. And that was one of the things I talked to him about. You know, in Jackson County, we have only two franchise restaurants. That'll be Applebee's and Ruby Tuesday. And as you can see, I'm a guy that loves to eat, and I like to eat good. I don't like hamburgers and french fries will kill me. I ain't gonna lie. I mean, high cholesterol run rampant through my family and diabetes and everything else. So I like eating good, balanced meal. Restaurants, to me, brings people to the barn, as they say. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
And it gets things moving. From everything. Would you try to start with bringing restaurants here or Walmart to the city of Moss Point? What would be the things that you would start your focus out when you become the state legislator here?
It's a combination of it all. You know, you have to start, and you say, well, where do you start? You start with education.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you must have an educated workforce. And in order to have an educated workforce, you must have a strong curriculum. You must have good teachers, administrators, and staff
mm-hmm.
to make this happen. And students who really want to learn, and parents. See, that's another factor that we have missed. Parenting is so important, because they need to be involved right. with their children 24/7.
Mm-hmm.
And then business and industry. If all the executives that are listening on your radio show, I would like to invite them to come to Moss Point. We're the best kept secret, just like Pascagoula is. We're the best kept secret. We got 100,000 of people traveling down I-10.
That's a fact.
We have all of the amenities that any business or industry need. We can also do a maritime division. We have Mississippi Export that comes into Moss Point, that travels all the way to Canada. They can bring products here that can be containerized, packaged, locked up, go loaded on barges and loaded midstream if we have to.
Mm-hmm.
If you need to store it, you have space in Goche, Moss Point, Ocean Springs, Pascagoula, that you can place this. You're providing jobs and services,
mm-hmm.
but you have to have investors to come in. We have land, we have water, we have rail, and we have airspace
and
for them.
That is true. That is true. Even Trent Lott is an international airport.
Yes, it is.
So you can operate a lot, bring overseas people here and you land can. Them right here in Moss Point.
And see, we're failing to understand and look, too. We need to partner with our community colleges and all our universities and colleges in this state to come and help our youth. Be prepared for the global competition
right.
and creativity. We have some students now. I met a young lady at Moss Point High School the other day. She wants to say that she wanted to design a new automobile and name it after her. Go ahead and do it, young lady, because it's important to get your patent in, because you never know. It's important.
That's a fact. And you spoke a second ago about bringing the educational system to a high. And what a lot of people don't understand is when you have an educational system that is at a high, operating off of a high level, that brings property value up. People don't realize that.
Every time you take a school and you shut it down, you're shutting your community down. So my message to all our leaders, our mayors, city councilmen, and aldermen, and persons who are involved in economic development, let's go out and partnership with our state,
mm-hmm.
partnership with the federal elected officials to bring industry here and businesses
mm-hmm.
here.
Mm-hmm.
Because if we have students who are very very interested in their education,
right.
an educated workforce is a strong workforce. And when you have that, and that brings me another point, I'm supporting building a new high school in Moss Point. All the other major cities have new schools.
That's a fact.
So I'm supporting this. I'm not sitting back on the fence and saying, I'm going to wait to see what they're going to do. I'm supporting them shoulder to shoulder. If we have to get on a bus, train, airplane to go and find money, that's what I'm willing to do. Because if you have a new high school, and we have land here, whether it's in the city
right.
limits or out of the area.
Ocean Springs just built theirs out of city.
Isn't it beautiful?
Yeah.
So I want to see the same thing happen to us and it increase the morale of the students.
So speaking about bringing more money to Moss Point, Mississippi, we're big on tourism, economic development. We're pretty much big on that. I think it's safe to say that.
We're real big.
Right. That's how the coast makes a lot of its money. You being elected here, how will you intertwine your connections up there in Jackson with tourism and bringing money to the city of Moss Point?
Well, first of all, I'll make an appointment with the governor, let him know that I'm interested. Then I will go to the Development Authority and talk with them. Then I will sit down with the Speaker of the House and the Lieutenant Governor, and as well as my colleagues, to see how we can form a coalition together and collaborate with our federal officials, and if necessary, the President and the Vice President, those who are in his cabinet, so that whatever it takes to bring industry here, because the South right now is a sleeping giant.
Okay? Right.
Then we have growth on our interstates that we can also sell. I would call it an I-10 corridor that can be developed.
Mm-hmm.
63, Highway 613, Highway 57. You know, everyone can profit from this. But if then we need to do the spinoff on the Airbus. Somehow, some way, someone have to go over and knock on the door and say, look, we have something to offer. We're interested in a spinoff of other businesses that can come, that will provide jobs, meaningful jobs, to our youth and to their families, so that we can continue to prosper.
You're speaking of in the future as well, down the line.
Down the
line. Grandkids, generations.
Yes.
You know, talking with you, what you are saying, I see that vision for this area, because this is the type. These are the conversations that I have around dinner tables when we're talking, and to have a man that's sitting in front of me that can take talk and make it a reality is a wonderful thing. And all I could do is talk about it. I'm not in that position. I've never been in that position before. All I could do is give guys like you the forum to speak about it. That's where I'm doing my part right now. And what you are saying is what this coast should be. Like you said, we have direct interstate traffic in here. 63, probably I say 50,000 people pass on it every day, going back and forth from Chevron, coming into the shipyards. It's a short way into your job.
Right.
I mean, we this place is booming. The coast is booming. It's the best kept secret. I do agree with you on that. From 57 to 63, even all the way to Franklin Creek.
Yes.
And then we have all this untapped land. You know, what can, I mean, I'm so with you on this.
Well, let me take it a little bit further. If we start developing, I'm fencing a golf course, okay? If we develop a golf course, then we could teach how do you maintain a golf course? How do you identify the proper vegetation and grass that need to grow on there? Then you have, if business people stop in, someone have to help take care of their family, their children.
Right.
All right. If you have if you teach this, how to help manage this, then a guy that's coming in to play golf, he doesn't have to worry about his children. They're safe. They're being taken care of. His wife can go shopping while he play golf.
Right.
And they're going to eat here. They're going to spend some money here. Why not?
There you go. That leads back to your the places to eat. I was talking to someone the other day, and I said, you know, me and Herman came and talking about bringing him in.
Yes.
And I asked, I said, I don't have a hotel to put him in over here.
You have hotels. You're just not aware of it. We have hotels. And they're good hotels.
Uh-huh.
When I was a building inspector for the city of Moss Point, we missed our bid on Olive Garden that was coming here. So it's all about people meeting people.
There you go.
If you have executives who are willing to relocate here, then if we don't ask not, we get not. So I'm hoping that they're listening and being interested in coming to Moss Point, see what we have to offer. We got the tourism thing. We have our Audubon Society. It's sitting there. It's moving. It's growing. Well, why not the local people sit down and take the advantage of it? Set up their tour boards, to get their boats so they can tour our beautiful rivers that we have here. We have estuaries that are so beautiful, untamed, and it's eye-catching, and it's very refreshing and relaxing. Then on the other hand, on the other side of the river, we have industry over there. So we have a common place where everyone can balance out.
To make everything successful.
And make everything successful. Our community can start growing again. Our schools can start filling, because people are not going to come where there's no growth.
Right. And for those that would like to, I guess, contact you, they could go to www.MitchEllerby.com, and that's MitchEllerby.com. And again, that's www.MitchEllerby.com. You got something you want to say?
Yeah, I have a question I'd like to ask.
Go ahead, sir. I'm ready.
All right. Now, this is something that I don't know maybe how far in depth you can answer, but to give our viewers more of a physical view, in our country, what city or state that you believe that pretty much share your same views, that people can look at and see how in the position that that city or state was in, and it grew economically and financial-wise, and tourism and people came to live here with growth, that you feel like that is a good example of what you...
There are two cities that I know of personally that I visit, and one is Savannah, Georgia, and the other is Charleston, South Carolina. Mm. This Charleston had a bad situation where their military left them. They turned it into something. They do containerized shipping out of there.
Right.
That's when I got this idea. Their downtown area have living quarters and up above, high level in the airspace. And then down below, they have the retail outlet. And they're right on the water. Savannah has basically the same thing. It's just the people in the community have to come together.
Mindset.
Elected official have. Did I answer your question, sir?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Hey, that's good, because I agree with you 100%. We have things around here that we can turn into stuff, like the base out here that got shut down, the island.
That can be used as a containerized shipping port.
You know?
All you have to do, if you don't have the investors here, the county don't have the money, reach out for it. And next time I come back, I want to talk about the help of public safety and our police and our first responders.
You can speak on it a little bit right now. You got a minute and a half.
Right.
You tell us right now, why should people vote for you?
People to vote for me because I am the person that can get the job done. I'm committed. I know the legislative process, and I can do what it has to do. I'm a good listener. Mm-hmm. I believe in the process in Mississippi. And if we can get some help to get me elected here in the Moss Point, those of you in the listening area outside, call your friends back in Moss Point and Pascagoula. Tell them to vote for Mitch Ellerby. I need your vote and support. And then, by the way, I want to give our kudos out to our law enforcement. Their cars need replacing. I've always supported law enforcement, whether it's county, municipal, or in the state, because our state troopers, they have been very blessed. So thank you for them and their support.
And that's what's up. And you said all that with 25 seconds to spare, man. So you're good at this.
Well, I want to thank you and your staff.
Yes, sir.
And is there any more questions that you want to ask me, sir?
No, sir. I'm good, sir.
People, here's a man of character, integrity. He needs your vote. Get out there. Tell people about him. Vote for him. He's been there. He already held his seat. People, we'll be right back.
Looking for that freshness and quality you've come to expect from a locally owned and operated supermarket? Well, Wayne Lee's in Pascagoula is the place. Whether it's their famous high-quality cuts of meat for that special dinner or just lunch on the go from their deli, come and taste the difference. Fresh-picked produce and a well-stocked variety of store-brand products are designed to save you money. They also carry a wide selection of outdoor items, from fishing gear to tree stands to outdoor wear. Your hometown market for quality since 1945. Open 7 days a week, 5 a.m. to 11 p.m. That's Wayne Lee's on Telephone Road near Highway 90 in Pascagoula.
Looking for a sign? CupidSigns.com is the sweetest little sign shop in the whole wide world. Go to CupidSigns.com to order your next banner, sign, or decal. No confusion, no hidden fees, and no nonsense. We provide the design work at no extra charge, shipping in most cases at no extra charge, and the fastest turnaround at no extra charge. We do, however, charge for your sign. But don't worry, you'll be pleased with our prices. Looking for a sign? You found one. CupidSigns.com.
Call Cupid Signs today at 228-712-2322.
This is Talk Radio 1580 WPMO Pascagoula, Moss Point, and 1440 WVGG Loosedale, the talk of South Mississippi.
With SRN News, I'm Keith Peters in Washington. President Obama is now embracing a two-track strategy on Syria.
Fast-moving developments have forced the White House to shift its strategy from just a couple of days ago, with Syria saying it supports a proposal to give up control of its chemical weapons stockpiles. The president supports UN talks to secure those weapons. But Mr. Obama also is pushing the fallback idea of U.S. airstrikes in case that effort fails.
SRN News White House correspondent Greg Clugston reporting the president's expected to address the nation from the White House in around an hour. Meanwhile, a Russian plan under which Syria would turn over its chemical weapons in order to avoid Western missile strikes is hitting some snags. The plan bogged down today when Moscow rejected U.S. and French demands for a binding UN resolution that would include very severe consequences for noncompliance. The proposal would put the chemical weapons of the Bashar Assad regime under international control before they're eventually destroyed. Michael Rubin of the American Enterprise Institute says even if Syria actually follows through on its pledge, the process could take months.
While it's easy to say that the Syrians are going to give up or submit to inspection their chemical arsenals, it's another thing to actually come to the modalities of doing so.
Also at SRNNews.com, House and Senate leaders are posthumously awarding Congress's highest civilian honor to four girls killed in an Alabama church bombing nearly 50 years ago. Four-year-olds Addie Mae Collins, Carol Robertson, and Cynthia Wesley, and 11-year-old Denise McNair are being honored on the 50th anniversary of their deaths at the hands of white supremacists. U.S. Senate Chaplain Barry Black thanks God that the victims didn't die in vain.
We praise you that their tragic deaths helped arouse the conscience of a nation.
The attack shocked the nation and helped spur passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965. This is SRN News.
If you're a responsible homeowner who's faithfully made your mortgage payments, you deserve thanks for doing the right thing. And I'd like to tell you about a powerful financial tool that rewards your responsibility. Hi, I'm Jay Farner, president of Quicken Loans, and the tool that I'm talking about is the Home Affordable Refinance Program, or HARP. HARP is designed to help you lower your mortgage payments. It's for responsible homeowners who are current on their payments, but due to the housing market, may have little or no equity left in their home. And even if you were unable to get a HARP loan in the past, new guidelines mean that now you may be eligible. Over 2.5 million homeowners have already taken advantage of HARP and are saving an average of $250 a month. If you're one of the millions yet to take advantage, call us today at 800-QUICKEN. To learn more, call Quicken Loans today at 800-QUICKEN or go to quickenloans.com. That number again is 800-QUICKEN.
Important terms and conditions apply. Call us for cost information. Equal housing lender. Licensed in all 50 states. NMLS number 33.
Four men have been...
Your local news from Loosedale to Long Beach begins on Talk Radio 1580 and 1440. A 50-year-old Pascagoula homeless man has been arrested on a sexual battery charge after police learned he was living in a homeless camp in a wooded area near Nathan Hall and Long Avenue with a 14-year-old female and having an inappropriate relationship with her. Joseph Eugene Barber was arrested yesterday. The department received information from the National Missing and Exploited Children Organization about a 14-year-old female runaway living in a homeless camp with a man named Eugene. Barber's bond was set at $25,000. He's in the Jackson County Adult Detention Center. The young girl was reunited with her family. The Mississippi Parole Board has started releasing a few inmates on the condition that they wear electronic monitoring devices that can be used to track their location. That word coming from Board Chairman Doug Davis yesterday. The board has approved ankle bracelets for about 20 people who have been convicted of nonviolent crimes. It's cheaper to put inmates on supervised release with an ankle bracelet than to pay for housing and food and medical expenses. Well, the buzzing of the cicadas are soon to come to an end, according to Gulf Coast entomologist Tim Lockley. They're still emerging, but the vast majority of the cicadas came out in June and July, and with the exception of a few stragglers, Mother Nature should have things once again quiet by mid-September. Two stations, one local newscast, the talk of South Mississippi. WPMO and WVGG, I'm Don Murley.
This is Sally Russell with your local weather forecast on Talk Radio 1580 and 1440 AM. High pressure will lead to very little chance of wet weather over the next couple of days. Tonight, partly cloudy. We drop down into the mid-70s for Wednesday. Sunshine high in the upper 80s, flirting with 90 with sunshine on Thursday and back in the upper 80s on Friday. That's your local weather forecast on Talk Radio 1580 and 1440 WPMO and WVGG. I'm meteorologist Sally Russell.
O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home has been serving the families of Jackson County since 1943. Since then, O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home has maintained a progressive approach in adjusting to the changes in our community. O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home is a full-service funeral home serving all denominations and customs and providing quality service to generations of families. O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home is prepared to handle any service or request your family may have with openness and understanding. All pre-needs or pre-arrangements can be transferred to O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home without any charge. A proud supporter of all of our area high schools, O'Brien O'Keefe Funeral Home is located on Telephone Road in Pascagoula and the only funeral home in Goshen on Ladner Road. Call 762-4311 for your pre-needs or any other questions you may have. We're here to answer at 762-4311.
If you have a legal issue that needs to be resolved, then call the Law Office of Dustin and Thomas P. LLC. We handle cases involving criminal, personal injury, family, and divorce law, as well as wills and estates. We'll see to it that your legal issue will be handled as quickly and efficiently as possible. Our focus is on getting you the best results for your case. Call the Law Office of Dustin and Thomas today at 228-696-8881. Get our team of professionals working on your side. Dustin and Thomas, a lawyer who understands, with offices at 525 Krebs Avenue in Pascagoula. Call 228-696-8881 or log on to DustinThomasLaw.com.
You might be dead. Ooh, Castro! Ain't that his name?
That's it.
Castro, them ladies reached out their hands to you. They had faith that you would just reach out and help them along the way. But all you did was put their hands behind their back and tied them up in the basement for 10 years and told them you'll be there! You punk!
Watch it now.
That was Castro. He said, I'm so glad I found y'all, girl. All I'm gonna do is keep your hand behind your back for the next 40 years of your life. And then as soon as they catch me, I'm just such a punk, I'm gonna kill myself. Killer music. This dude, Ariel Castro, man, you are... Hold up. I'm going Ebonic. You is a... fool, you is a punk. I don't understand this dude. You trying to tell me you can keep these girls locked up for 10 years and you can't take 10 days in jail? You punk, weakling, sorry individual. I ain't gonna even call him a man. He's not a man. I can't even call him a woman. You ain't nothing. He is nothing. And then you got people getting on TV that post to know this dude talking about, well, you know, to look into his mom's eye, she didn't deserve this. What he did, she just did not deserve this. Man, ain't nobody studying his grown mama. And this man is 60 years old. Is his mama still alive? Yeah, she's still alive because she talked to him in jail. Let's talk about these 12-year-old girls that, you know what I'm saying, that you kidnapped when they were 12. One of them, mama died of a broken heart, said the autopsy. You know, before, and this is crazy, man. You got something you want to say about this fool?
I don't know where to start, man.
Hey, that's how I felt about it. I don't know where to start.
I mean, from people who come on TV talking about feel sorry for him, and I mean, where's the balance in that? Like, how do they even come out your mouth?
Let me tell you what really happened, though. Let me tell you what really happened. He had assistants hanging himself. He probably had assistants from every inmate in there. You know what I'm saying? Because he think this bad that you got to do, what, a thousand years. Yeah. I was just making that up. They had really had 1,000 years? Yeah. I was just making that up. I knew he had a thousand years in prison. You know you're going to spend the rest of your life in prison. And see, it's kind of like the military, like joining the military. Oh, I'm leaving my parents. I can't stand being told what to do. So I'm going to just join the military. Yeah. You know? And that's what it's like with him.
Would you look at it? I mean, I never been to jail, though, but the few days he was there, ain't no telling what them jail mates was, what he was going through.
Right.
Because I'm sure they punished him for doing that to them girls like that.
Right. Rightfully so. And here he is. He can't do a couple hours in jail.
And, you know, if I was one of the guards over there, like, watching the prisoners, you know, I might be able to overlook some of the stuff that gets done to him by the other inmates.
Yeah. I know I might be able to overlook it. I am going to overlook it. Matter of fact, I am going to help them do whatever they're trying to do to him. The only thing that I'm not going to do is be physically involved.
That's just like,
I'm going to stand and let the other inmates be physical.
In the case right now, two of the correctional officers actually on leave that was, you know, was on duty that night.
Yeah, we watched them. So, I mean, what? I mean, now that's the time. See, these people need me at all times. This is the time you pay the officers. You suspend them with pay. This is the first time you suspend them with pay. You don't suspend them with pay with the Rodney King situation and all the other stuff. Suspend them with pay on this one. You know what I'm saying? And it's insane. You trying to tell me that you can dish it out for 10 years, raping these girls every chance you got, impregnating them, whatever you want to do, and walk out the house like you're a good, upstanding citizen while you got girls locked in your basement in a dungeon? You talk about, what's that movie? It got like five of them out, six of them out. Saw. These girls, they couldn't watch a movie like Saw. They scarred.
Yeah.
Running out. I mean, do you know their life? You have took these girls' youth. These people are 30 years old. No college, a kid. And then, you know, I feel sorry for the little girl. How do you be that girl and walk around? My daddy kidnapped my mama that raped her. That's how I'm here. And then as the girl, the mother, you have to walk around with the scar of your child, even though you love your child because you felt y'all was in this together. But this is a constant remembrance of the scar, of the tragedy that was done to you for 10 years. And imagine being taken away as a kid, man. I mean, you wasn't kidnapped as a 20-something-year-old man or 20-something-year-old woman. To be taken away from your parents, it's like insane. I remember when I was a young boy, man, we went to the post office, me and my daddy. Man, I turned around, that man was gone. You know, back in them days, the post office had about a 6-inch window at the top. It bordered the top of the post office. You was like in prison. Couldn't nobody see out no windows. They all the way at the top of the building. And it was like, where'd this man go? You know what I'm saying? I remember both of my parents left me in a car one time and went in the store. Where are they at? Man, you know, you going crazy. Man, I'm a kid, man. What the flip? Now, here you got some strange man you ain't never seen in your life just then grabbed you and pulled you off a bicycle while you was out skating and then kept you. This ain't even over. When is this over? Every day them girls thinking, when will this be over? I'm sure them girls wanted to kill themselves. I'm sure they wanted to hang themselves. But he wouldn't give them nothing to kill themselves with.
And that's something I wonder, you know, and they probably said it, I just don't know. But I'm sure that these females, these girls wanted this man dead. But at the same time, they probably wanted him to suffer. So, I mean, because to them, it probably don't really serve justice for them to keep them for 10 years. And he don't serve probably a month or two in jail and kill himself. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I wonder how they feel. Like, yeah. Man, I want him to suffer for a while like I suffered. You know, killing yourself, that's the easy way out in the worldly sense, though. But
yeah, because see, that's what I was going to say, too. You know, that he did this and killed himself. But see, the trick is on him. The joke is on him. If he killed himself, you thought. That's why I said that earlier. I didn't get around to finishing about, you know, going to military. I'm tired of people telling me what to do, so I'm going to just join the military. And everybody in the military tell you what to do. You ain't never doing what you want to do when you're in there. But that's the reason why you ran away from home, because you're tired of people telling you what to do. But he didn't want to go to prison because prison was too hard for him to bear. Prison is overbearing, so I'm just going to kill myself. I can't take this. This is just out of control. This is way too much for me. Too many guys that's way stronger than me, bigger than me, probably holding me down, giving me the time of my life in here. The thrill that I cannot fulfill. So I just killed myself. Now you have put yourself in something that you definitely cannot bear. Why? God made hell for you not to bear. And jail is nothing like hell. Actually, jail is a nice hangout spot if you don't plan on going anywhere for a while, especially if you grab a Snickers.
And hell probably, jail probably has more necessities than that. Some people have their own house, man.
And jail have TVs. Jail have a well-balanced food on a schedule. You're going to eat in the morning. You're going to eat at lunch, and you're going to eat dinner. Those are your three meals. And anything in there, hey, if you got family that's willing to have money on your books, you got a hot in the cot. Some of y'all are like, what? You got a what? I say you get three hots in a cot. That means you get three hot meals and you get a bed, a cot to sleep on. You know? And that's jail. That's wonderful life for somebody who ain't going nowhere. He ain't gonna do nothing with his life no way. So this dude making like $100,000 a year doing this. Because if he had to come out here and live in the world and guarantee meals all day, guarantee AC when it's cold, when it's hot, guaranteeing heat, guaranteeing everything, exercise, basketball, and the light bill, water bills around that ain't that's getting paid. He ain't got to pay for none of this. And it's guaranteed good living, man. If you ain't got nothing going on in your life and you a scumbag anyway, you might as well just go hang out at jail for a couple years. Matter of fact, just make a career out of it. That's what most people do. They just go down there and make a career out of it. I'll be right back. As soon as they let you out, I'm coming back. And then you got your girlfriend in there waiting on you when you get in there. So you having sex and you eating three meals a day. Man, you sound like you Bill Clinton. You know what I'm saying?
Man, now, you know, they always talking about how they want less people in jails, have less sentences for people who do, like, drug offenders and all that. I mean, instead of doing stuff like that, just think about make jail tougher, man.
Yeah.
Make jail jail.
Yeah, make jail jail. No, make jail hell.
Yeah. I used to be, man. I guarantee you would think twice we're going to rob a bank if you know.
If we tied his telephone,
You locked into a dungeon with your hands tied to a brick all day.
Yeah.
And you feed them chicken broth. You know, a whole bowl, like in the movies. They just taking a spatula.
No shave, no razor to shave with.
And a wooden bed.
Yeah.
Well, some of their beds is worse. You know, you go in the hole, you sleeping on concrete. But yeah, a wooden bed. Just something that's not so comfortable and cozy. I mean, these guys got flat screen TVs. They hanging out. See, it's too much downtime. See, these guys sit around running their mouth. Yeah, man, I play the cards, man, in a football game. No, jail need to be where you ain't interested in football. You just want out of here. I bet you a man in today's society that get a 35-year sentence 1 year in my jail prison would be like an eternity in a day jail.
Yeah.
You know, I really, if you tie a man to a log every day and make him pull it up a hill, tie him to the whole tree. Don't take no branches off.
Yeah.
Now, this is what you do for your punishment for what you did. You get 3 hours of sleep every night, a cup of water, and about 10 sardine crackers. And, you know, start making jail a little tougher. I agree with you. Make jail a little tougher and keep them isolated from others. All this hanging out. See, jail is a hangout. People got to understand how these guys' lives are. The majority of people that go to prison, now everybody in prison ain't guilty. But I'm talking about the ones that are guilty. Majority of these guys are hanger-outers. They've been hanging out all their life, and that's pretty much how they got in trouble, just hanging out. And when they go to prison, you hanging out with your same buddies that you was hanging out with in the streets. So it ain't a problem. You in there doing the same thing. You fighting. You can't get sentenced. I'm already sentenced. Yeah. All they can do is come in here and water hose us. Then when we get out, we get to talk about how, well, man, I punched that security guard in his face. And I mean, you know, just like you were saying when you was out here on these streets. But it's going to be hard to punch the security guard in his face when your both your fists are cuffed to a brick wall. And your nickname is Jesus. You know? And your feet are stuck in a concrete that can be chipped off on your day of release.
One thing that would make jail awful right now, I think y'all might have said it, but no air conditioning. That would make it terrible.
Yeah.
It's like, I know some of them, I mean, I guess watching like documentaries and stuff, some of them jails in Mexico that, you know, they kind of like that, man. They have 10, 15 people, and your clothes, you basically have what you have on when you came into jail.
Right.
And it's up to your family to bring you some clothes to wear, you know.
So Castro had it way better than any overseas jail.
Yeah.
He has it way better than a lot of people out here on the streets. That's why during Christmas time, a lot of people just go to jail. Thanksgiving, they go and do commit crimes to go to prison. Well, to your local county so that they can eat. That's a proven fact. It's been that way. So I'm ready. Let me tell you what I hate. This is what should have happened to him. People, y'all say what y'all want to say to me. Y'all can call in and talk bad about me, whatever you want to do. I don't care. But what should have happened to him, somebody should have went in there with a Bible and witnessed to him. See, Castro, you need to get saved. Get on saved now, Castro. Pull that story up next. Castro, get saved. As soon as Castro gets saved, the same guy that went in there with the Bible just need to jump on him and beat him to death. Bro, did you get saved? Yeah, I got saved. Now go to, boom, kill him. That's what. that's what. Hey, it's the love of God in me is the only reason I'm witnessing to you. Right before I knock your teeth out. Hey, Jesus wanted me to tell you something.
Hey. Do it to him every day, huh?
Did you just say it yet? Boom, go to sleep. Knock him out. Man, that's what he needed every day. Oh, man, why could I have been an inmate for like 10 minutes with about 10 other guys that felt the way I felt? Of course, man, talking about people that's crazy, man, Zimmerman. Zimmerman is insane. Now, people, I know a lot of y'all felt like Zimmerman should have got off. I was telling y'all then, and I'm telling y'all now. Zimmerman is a nutcase. Since this man has been acquitted of murder, because that's what he did, because that's who he is. I told y'all that. He let that boy hit him so he can get him on the ground and shoot him. And then he could say, he was on top of me. I'm out here hollering. This is what he, this is the guy that he is. He's been waiting to shoot somebody. He ran after that boy, ran him down, and he shot him. That's what he did. I don't care about Trayvon punching, throwing, nothing. You talk about a 17-year-old kid, and you a grown 30-year-old man with a gun on you that outweighed Trayvon by 60 pounds. All you had to do was pull a gun on him, Trayvon wouldn't approach you no more. You ran him down. The man defended himself. Since he been acquitted, he has had 3 run-ins with the police. One all the way in Texas. Another time, 2 weeks ago in Florida. It ain't been quite 2 weeks. Well, now, yesterday, his wife, the lady that's doing a year on paper, on probation, right now, his wife had to call the police on him because his judge father and his wife called the police and said, Zimmerman has a gun on me and his father. She called scared to death for her life, for her survival. This is the guy that they just acquitted. The Mr. guy, the nice guy, the one that love all kids. Whatever. Zimmerman is a criminal, just like Castro. He's a murderer. That's his MO. That's the guy he loves to be. He loves to be a thug. Now he has been acquitted of murder, and now he feels he's untouchable. That's what he feel. He feel he untouchable. And the lady that lied for him, see, that's what she get too. You lie for him as the wife, I understand you covering. That's what you better do, because you know Zimmerman, he'll probably shoot you. You know, he do have one under his belt, my wife. So she went on with it. Now the same guy you protected has now pulled a gun on you. People think about it. I'm going to be back to trash Zimmerman a little bit more.
This is Sally Russell with your local weather forecast on Talk Radio 1580 and 1440 AM. High pressure will lead to very little chance of wet weather over the next couple of days. Tonight, partly cloudy. We drop down into the mid-70s for Wednesday. Sunshine, high in the upper 80s. Flirting with 90 with sunshine on Thursday and back in the upper 80s on Friday. That's your local weather forecast on Talk Radio 1580 and 1440, WPMO and WVGG. I'm meteorologist Sally Russell.
Emerson Sporting Goods, serving the Gulf Coast since 1988, invites you to stop in today for all of your custom screen printing, embroidery, and sports equipment needs. Emerson Sporting Goods custom screen printing services are available for churches, schools, individuals, businesses, and other group organizations. Need sports equipment? Well, Emerson Sporting Goods stocks only the best brand names in the business for all of your football, basketball, baseball, and softball needs. Emerson Sporting Goods, located on Highway 613, just 5 miles north of the Hurley four-way stop near the Jackson George County line. Call 228-588-3952.
Don't let a frozen screen frustrate you. Microsource on Dito Road in Gulfport is your one-stop source for all your IT needs. Our fully insured and trained staff offer more than 20 years' experience serving customers all across the coast. From office systems and servers to home computers, Microsource specializes in sales, repairs, and support services. So whether you're shopping for the best deal, an upgrade, data recovery, or a complete custom rebuild for your special needs, come by for a consultation at 14472 Suite A, Dito Road in Gulfport, or call 831-0001. That's 831-0001.
Turf Masters Lawn Care has been engineering beautiful lawns and landscapes around Harrison and Jackson counties, from residential lawns to businesses to athletic fields, for over 10 years. Now they want to help you create or restore your own personal paradise with their fabulous line of pottery, water features, chimeneas, shrubs, palm trees, and so much more. Turf Masters Lawn Care has opened a brand new garden center and nursery just north of Cape Awan on Macphilia Road in Pascagoula, with over 7,000 annuals grown locally per quarter and an amazing variety. Stop by and select the plants that go with your vision. Then let the Turf Masters crew come and bring that vision to life through landscaping, irrigation, installation, or repairs. Turf Masters also offers complete grounds maintenance service. Open Monday through Friday from 8 to 5 and Saturdays from 8 till 2. Call 228-475-3665 or log on to turfmasterslc.com or like them on Facebook at facebook.com/turfmasterslawn.
Care.
Stan Sanzoni for Perkins Tire and Polaris. Razor Sharp Performance is waiting for you. Take your pick of the best side-by-side sports machines the industry has by Polaris. Dominate the trails in a 50-inch RZR 800 or 570, or bring your friends along in a four-seat RZR 4 or XP4. Or you can slide behind the wheel of the undisputed king of high performance, RZR XP900. Every RZR is built to deliver the ultimate combination of power, suspension, and agility. That's Razor Sharp Performance waiting for you at Perkins Tire and Polaris, Highway 90, Pascagoula.
ATVs and side-by-side vehicles can be hazardous to operate. Polaris adult models are for riders age 16 and older. Always wear a helmet and be sure to take a training course. Polaris ATVs and side-by-side vehicles are not intended for on-road use.
Cause you a murdering, murderous man. Is your name O.J. Simpson? Or is just plain old Zimmerman? Yeah, no, old Zimmerman. You need to quit punching on your wife that took that charge for you. Now her credit all messed up and she about to go to jail. If she miss a payment, she going to jail. Because you stupid. And she didn't file for a divorce on you. She held on just so you can win that case. Killer music.
So you're telling me this woman didn't file for a divorce?
Yeah, that's correct. I believe like a month after Zimmerman beat the charges.
Now why you think she filed for a divorce? If your husband and you just went through all this famous case, they said they ain't had no money in the bank. I talked to y'all about that. The man found out they had like $200,000 in the bank. For a man that ain't have a job, how you get $200,000 in the bank? That should tell you something right there.
Did she work or it was a?
I don't care. If she worked at the shipyard, she ain't got $200,000 in the bank.
Yeah, it's a lot of money.
I don't care if you're a school teacher. She ain't got $200,000 in the bank. And looking at her, she ain't no lawyer that's making Zimmerman lawyer kind of money. They doing something they ain't got no business doing. That's just bottom line. Because look at his lifestyle after the trial. Dude, you ain't been innocent, found innocent for a whole month yet. You worse than Johnny Manziel. Johnny Manziel gets put back on the field. He ain't acting crazy 2 weeks in a row. It's their mentality. People, I don't make these things up. It's their mentality. Johnny Manziel isn't going to ever act right on nobody's team. He's a good player, and he feels that he should and could act like this. Except for when he get cut and find out you're not needed. Not that you're not needed. I didn't say not needed. I said you're not needed. Okay? Now, Zimmerman. His wife said to some reporters, right?
Yeah, I believe it was on CNN or ABC News.
She
interviewed. Well, one of her exact words was that ever since Zimmerman beat the trial, she believed that Zimmerman felt like he's invincible.
And you know that he does. Yeah. He does. He's been on trial for... He was on trial. That was the most famous case this year. This year. And I see the interview right there. And this guy is a nut job. That's just the bottom line. Zimmerman is a nut job. Somebody needs to, they need to just go and lock him up before he kills somebody else or kill himself. I mean, if he kill himself, that's fine. Him and Castro will be beside each other in hell. So, as long as you ain't hurting other people. So she filed for divorce. Divorce with an innocent man. Now, that woman filed for divorce because she know the man is walking around the house cocky, going off all the time, pulling a gun like he did. Now, you said it just popped up about an hour and a half ago that the wife and the father.
Yeah, they dropped the charges. Like, they're saying now that he never had a gun. A gun was never involved. So they changing their story.
Yeah, because they know he'd kill him. Don't tell on me. Man, Zimmerman probably in the bathroom every day pointing the gun at the mirror. with a cop badge stuck to his chest, yeah. With no shirt on, no t-shirt on, just got a cop badge stuck to his chest. A Sherlock Holmes gangster pipe in his mouth, some shades, a scarf round his neck, and talking like he a soprano.
Probably trying to see how fast he can pull the gun out of the
hose. And I'm going to tell you, she going to fool around and pop him.
Hey, to answer your question earlier, you was asking, you know, why do I think she filed for divorce, which you kind of mentioned, but I want to add to it that more likely, Zimmerman been like this ever since she been with the man.
Bottom line.
And the last straw for her was that
he killed that boy,
and this is a no.
And you would think, but you know, people don't think until it's them. She's seeing it now. I bet right now she's telling her family, I should have let his stupid tail go to jail.
Yeah.
I should have let them have his tail, fry his tail. But not at the time. And, you know, everybody won't take up for their kids and they husband and their wife and their daughter until their kid turned the knife on you.
Because the way he acting and the stuff he been in since this going on, man.
Been like that.
He ain't gonna tell that man know he killed that boy. Yeah. I mean, just like the guy he acting now.
Right after. You can't even go sit down for a year.
Yeah, you think you'd be hiding out somewhere, man. I just be the case, man. Even I mean, especially if I know I did it on purpose,
I ain't
man.
Giving no interviews. I'm laying low, man.
Yeah.
That's just the bottom line. And what's this killer up here? What's this guy named, the drunk driving killer? I want y'all to play this here thing. I'm gonna talk about this fool here too. All these foolish people on here tonight. What is the deal? What's going on in the world, man? Play this clown.
Hey,
my name is Matthew Cordell.
Matthew Cordell, you a cluck.
And on June 22nd, 2013,
yeah.
I hit and killed Vincent Canzani.
He has not been convicted. He has not even been formally charged.
That's fine.
When I get charged, I'll plead guilty and take full responsibility for everything I've done to Vincent and his family.
On the night a wrong-way driver slammed into the car of Vincent Canzani on I-670, 22-year-old Matthew Cordell reportedly admitted to police that he'd been drinking, an admission that was backed up by the medical staff at Grant Hospital, who described him as very, very drunk. Now, he describes himself as remorseful. In a video that begins with his face blurred, he admits he consulted high-powered attorneys.
They were convinced that they could get my blood test thrown out.
What?
And all I would have to do.
Oh, that's the rest of the view. Now, let me tell you something. Why? I don't know if they already had this guy. If they didn't know that you're the one that did it, why would he come forth and do this? They had to already know he did it. So he trying to be famous, be known, make some money off of a book. Because to me, I don't like his cocky plea. When I first saw it last week, I said, this is a cocky fool. That ain't embarrassment and shame to me. I want to get on national television, tell all of y'all what to do right. Hold up, Cluck. You the one that did it. I didn't do it. So I need to tell you what to do. I want to tell y'all how not to drink and drive and kill nobody. Well, I'm a professional at that. I haven't drunk and killed anybody. I'm the professional at that, sir. Mr. Front. What's his name again? Pull up that Cluck's name. I'm the professional at not being drunk and driving.
Yeah.
You don't have no grounds to tell us that are not drinking and driving that we don't need to drink and drive because we don't do that.
Yeah. Hey, that's how most people are, man. I not to say any names, but I'm dealing with somebody like that, man.
Matthew Cordell, something like
that. Yeah, Matthew Clucko. That's the same. I mean, this is insane. And then you put out a... Let me tell you how I knew that he had money behind him. people, for those of y'all, I know y'all don't know me like that, but I've dealt with videos. You know, I've been in the entertainment business, man. Music, videos, all this type stuff. And I'm going to just tell you right now, the video that shot that commercial, that's not a cheap video. That's not a cheap camera. That's a professional camera that shot that video. The sound quality, excuse me, the sound quality on his voice is great. And when I first saw this air on CNN, I told my people that was around me, I said, whoever shot that video, somebody got some money behind him that's pushing this. They pushing this for another reason. Somebody. Now I hear his lawyers told him, we can get the blood test dropped. We can get this, that, and we can get that, that. He really feels he's going to get off. So he dropped that video for his personal self-gain. After the fact that he gets off. Travel around giving speeches to kids about don't drink and drive. He's going to do it again. Matter of fact, I bet you he is drunk and drive since he killed that man. That's just the way those kind of people are.
Just like Anthony Weiner kept on using that cell phone.
Yeah, the dude is a jerk. That's just the bottom line. Bottom line, he needs the book thrown at him. Well, he went to court today. You heard him say, I'm going to plead guilty and accept our responsibility for what I did. You heard him when he said that, right?
Yeah, I heard.
Well, today he went to court. Guess what he did? Pled not guilty. Yeah, it got real over the weekend, huh? Got really real. He pled not guilty.
How can
to
you
that.
Plead that when you put that video on YouTube?
Well, he didn't say he was, excuse me, he didn't plead guilty on YouTube. Pleading guilty to the judge and declaring something on the internet are two different things. So the judge said, look, we go to court Monday, Wednesday, and Friday around here for these things. She said, this is a monkey wrench. I was not expecting this. I was blindsided. I thought you was going to plead guilty today. I was going to give you your sentence today. Simple as that. But them 6-7 years he was looking at, he just couldn't bring himself to do it. So his lawyers, they cooked up something, and they said this is kind of pretty much standard procedure to have him to plead innocent. That's so his trial now has to be heard by another judge, entirely different judge. It's all stupid. Lock the man up. Throw him away. Lawyers that's defending him, let me tell you something. That kind of person, tomorrow he'll be killing your mama. Because he's drunk and driving. He'll be killing your mama. And you'll be so hot. You'll go over there and kill yourself. That you done just got help this man do this again. I say let him rot in prison. That's where he deserved to be. Rot in prison. Him and Zimmerman needs to rot in prison. And then they can off themselves. And then they can rot in hell with Castro. And they all get on down there and have one good old big party. With the other demons. You know what I'm saying? I mean, let's just be real here, man. I mean, just really. Now, if you could go through something and change your life, but see, man, this dude killed the man. This man was a grandfather. The man been living his life. The man probably was a good godly church man every day, minding his own business, and you just up here driving drunk and reckless. I bet he been a problem to his people his whole life. I bet he been a problem. Just like Zimmerman been a problem and Castro been a problem to his people his whole life. People don't just pop up overnight and show you that they crazy. People don't just pop up and show you that they just not having a problem. These people been having problems. O.J. Simpson been had a bad attitude. That didn't just start today. You can believe that there. Just like this 8-year-old boy that shot it. Pull it up.
Yeah, I got it over right now.
This 8-year-old boy down in Louisiana shot his 87-year-old grandmama in the head. He intentionally shot and killed his elderly caregiver after playing a violent video game. This woman, Miss Mothers, was pronounced dead at the scene with a gunshot wound to the head in a mobile home park in Slater, Louisiana. Now, here's the problem with this story. They trying him. He supposed to have a trial today. But the only problem about that is an 8-year-old kid can't go to trial. In nobody's court, an 8-year-old kid can't go to trial.
I don't know what you do about something like that.
I do. I know what to do about it.
Like, what do they do about it, though?
I was just talking about what I do about it.
Man, we don't know what
that is
time.
A tough
you
one, man.
You don't know what they do.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's
you know, I mean, people, I feel like if I got you on camera stealing the money out the bank, especially and then you 8 years old, man, I mean, it's an easy decision to make.
lock
them up. Ain't nothing to discuss.
Ain't nothing to talk about.
I mean, this is you right here.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, with the short hair, with the shorts on, you got that mark that you got cut with, probably trying to shoot somebody before and they stabbed you in your
arm. See, they got houses. They got homes for bad kids and runaway kids and kids that commit crimes at a kid. I mean, lock his tail up and keep him in there to have a loan. You'll give a grown adult for that sentence. And he probably, if he 8 years old now, you can probably let him out when he's 24. He didn't went through all of the systems. He graduated in jail, and he went to the Poshman when he was 18 years old. They sent him to the big house. So you're going to have to spend your last 6 years in a penitentiary system somewhere, preferably Angola. And being that he was so young when he did it, we won't give him life. We'll just give him next to life. You know what I'm saying? The dude, this is ridiculous, man. Ridiculous. Because he got mad. And then they want to blame it on a video game. You know, like he don't know what he's doing. Man, I used to be 8 years old. You know what I'm saying? I used to be 8. That's the thing these people, these Democrat liberals don't understand.
And play video games.
Yeah. I used to be 8 and play video games and shot guns.
Yeah.
Me and my dad and everybody else, when we were growing up, we used to shoot guns. And all of us have been hunting. All of us have been fishing.
And then the video game thing, because they mentioned that in that article, because, what about violence in movies? I mean, before video games got violent and all that, movies been shooting people and killing people and all
Wild
that stuff.
Wild West, Long Ranger, Clint Eastwood.
And then, I mean, we can talk about it on that segment.
Let's just start.
Now, on that segment, I want to talk about how the government Obama trying to push it where he want to do research on figure out why kids.
I'm researching for him to research how big this board going to be. People, we'll be right back.
Gulf Sales and Supply wants everyone to know that whether you need one more tool for that honey-do list this weekend, or if you're a contractor in need of hundreds, they are your source to save you time and money. Top quality tools from leading manufacturers including DeWalt, Makita, Porter Cable, Klein, Milwaukee, Pronto, or 3M, and much more. Over 400,000 items are available from over 2,000 vendors. Stop by today at 1909 Kenneth Avenue, Pascagoula, and let their highly knowledgeable crew find the perfect tool for your job. That's Gulf Sales and Supply at 762-0768.
The new Hibachi Grill and Buffet is now open in Pascagoula. They have the largest all-you-can-eat cuisine in Jackson County with fresh sushi made to order, Chinese and Japanese buffet items, and Asian-style hibachi sizzling on the grill. They also have barbecue, pizzas, desserts, and a whole lot more. Book your special occasion in their party room with seating for over 80. To-go menus are available by request. Located in the old Buffalo Wild Wings next to Big Lots on Highway 90 in Pascagoula. The all-new Hibachi Grill and Buffet. Call 696-0888.
It's Baber's $10 delivers your way. Anything in the store delivered your way for just $10. Bedroom, living room sets, dining room, $10 delivers your way. HDTVs, computers, washer dryers, refrigerators, $10 delivers your way at Baber's. There's no credit needed, delivery included, and 100% satisfaction guaranteed. $10 delivers your way. For a location near you, log on to babers.com.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. Now, we was talking about the little kid that shot his grandmother in the face and killed her. But, Ty, you want to say something right quick before I move on to the next story? Go on.
Yeah, at the end of the segment, I was mentioning how, you know, the Obama administration, especially ever since that Sandy Hook killing, you know, he was pushing for the scientists and, you know, the scholars and whoever type people to do research on on violent, the link between violent video games and people who go out and kill people or movies or et cetera. You know, it's just, I mean, the thing is on that, man, common sense, man, you don't need no research. People been killing people since the beginning of time. Cain slew Abel. And then you look at it, Cain didn't have a video game.
Yeah, he did. Look at Ask Obama, he had a video game too.
Look at the mafia. Excuse me, look at all the killing they did. You think they sat around with a video game? Oh, that's what we're going to do, y'all.
Yeah. Hey, so you trying to tell me Al Capone had no video game?
Nah, he had no video game. He was an evil, crazy man. A fool, man.
Well, that's what's up then, man. I don't really know how you try that case, but I know what I do to him. You got to go. I going to lock his little 8-year-old behind up, and we'll see what he going to do. You know what I'm saying? We're going to see where it go. But it's a story brewing out of Oklahoma State, the Cowboys. Now, see, they just beat my boy last week, Mississippi State. So they should have brought these allegations out before they played us. That's where we could have benched about 32 of their players. Because Mississippi State, we needed all the help we could get. We just couldn't do nothing with the ball last week. Well, they saying that this university, which we all know universities pay all players pretty much, you know. Hey, if I'm a star athlete, you need to pay me too. Well, they saying they had women escorts to show these guys around campus and have sex with them to induce them to help them make up their mind to sign with this college. Well, they said some of the guys was receiving $2,000 annually, others about $10,000. They said multiple players told a few of them received $25,000 or more. They saying, I guess Josh Field played in the NFL now. He was a quarterback. He supposed to take money. Tatum Bell, running back for Broncos. And Durant Williams, he was shot to death back in 2007. I mean, when that happened. He played for Denver Broncos. And they were saying how these guys took money and a lot of other people. People, let's just face it. Yeah, I'm going to take the money. I'm 18 years old. I sure am. I'm going to take the money and the woman. Bottom line. You offer me a fine woman to help me sign with this university and about $2,000 or $3,000 or $10,000 or, you know, $500. I'm signing. Simple as that. Why? The other college didn't offer me nothing. So guess what? All you want me to do is come out here and get hurt. At least I'm going to get some money and a woman before I come get hurt. So it is what it is. The other colleges, y'all just need to quit hating. Y'all hating. Y'all should have had some women to show them guys around. They'd have signed to your university. They were saying, how did Oklahoma State come from the bottom to the top? Well, that's how it happened. You answered your own question. She was on the bottom, now she on the top. Bottom line. Bottom line. Cream rises. You know what I'm saying? And that's the bottom line. They sent them young boys up, set them up with some of the finest hookers they could find, escort service, and them boys signed. And it is what it is.
But see, throughout the season too, the boys, they was getting bonuses too on how they played, their performance level. They was supposed to get
this bonuses. Is still a business. Don't believe this. We here for your kid, helping you. No, it is a business. And if these guys, man, like I was saying here a week or two ago about paying Johnny Manziel and all these guys, yeah, you man, to me, college uses these kids. They're being used to me. And some people are, well, they're getting an education. Nah, some of these kids are still paying their way through. They on half a scholarship, but they still, even though, say they are on full scholarship, they ain't getting no money for gas. They ain't getting no money for food, pretty much. You know what I'm saying? I mean, they do have a food thing, but it ain't enough. Probably like going to prison.
And just like we mentioned last week, the scholarships, they degrees, a lot of these degrees ain't about talking about nothing.
Yeah, you ain't getting no job with it.
Yeah.
And the ones that they up there to get, they ain't going to hire you with that no way. Because the one we want to hire for our corporation just graduated from Stanford or Samford or Yale. You know, we ain't looking for you out of Oklahoma State to develop no rocket.
You know what I'm saying? Actually, they do, though. Oklahoma, that university teams with the government do stuff like that.
You know, they somebody making a paycheck. So my thing is this, man. If we want our organization that's at the bottom to be on the top, look, man, sex sells. That's been the number one thing since the beginning of time. Sex sells. You know what I'm saying? Sex has brought every man down in the Bible that was willing to be brought down in the Bible. I mean, just think, yeah, man, I don't have to tell you a story. Y'all go read the Bible. You know what I'm saying? Bottom line. And here we go again. You talk about some 17-year-old kids on a recruitment trip, and all of a sudden these rich guys... Because, see, I don't see why we got to hold the kids accountable for this stuff. You're talking about grown men that are in their 50s and 60s that's doing this, setting these boys up for this. You know, the escort girls don't know that, oh, I think Oklahoma State is looking for a couple of hookers today. I think I'll just ride down there and offer my services and render them up. Ain't nobody doing that. Y'all are seeking these people out. They paid them girls to escort them guys around the campus. They paid them girls nicely to keep their mouth shut. Boosters, everybody else throwing money in their hat in the pot. This is what this money over here for. And you better believe that pot probably full of $50,000, $60,000, $100,000 to bring in 10 kids and 10 women. And you know they try to pick the finest of the finest. And yes, guys at that age just now experiencing sex, or some of them are still virgins. And yeah, they gonna take it. Yeah, they gonna do it. And the bottom line, they went to being competitors. You know what I'm saying? And to tell you the truth, I actually had a friend that went to up here at his university. He was a running back. Yeah, that's a fact.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he gonna take it. You think he ain't? And he did go on to the league. So, I don't understand the players that left that's telling. I don't get that.
Yeah, why not?
This is what happened. Yeah, why now? This is what got you through college. This is what made you your money. You know, quit messing it up for these other boys coming up. Yeah. Now I got to get put on probation because of what y'all did 10 years ago. Just like Reggie Bush, they didn't took my Heisman. And, man, it's 6-7 years later, man. Come on, when is... Even a court system got statute of limitation on things.
Yeah.
You know, after 7 years, you know, you're supposed to pull up no more charges on nobody. Man, let that stuff go, man. Who cares what happened 100 years ago? And by the way, they ain't the only college doing it. So why do we care? They ain't the only college doing it. Bottom line.
It's like now, man, a lot of stories have been going on. Like the new norm now is that you get in trouble for what you did 20 years ago, right, and what you're doing now.
Then what you're doing now. Like you said, everybody got to blame something on somebody else. And then if you think about it, I mean, you know, and I'm not saying that Ole Miss is doing nothing illegal. I'm not saying that. But all I know is, why is Ole Miss all of a sudden had the second best recruiting class in the nation this year? They starting all these blue chip All-American freshmen. Ole Miss in 2 years going to be true, really true blue contenders. Now, why did these kids go to Ole Miss all of a sudden? The best players in the world. All of a sudden, all of these guys just went to Ole Miss. All of them. Why is that? And then 10 years from now, if I were Ole Miss, paid 5 of them to come there. So, they would have went to somebody else. If Ole Miss didn't pay them, Alabama would have. I mean, Mississippi State been on probation. We just got on probation, bruh. From what Jackie Sherrill did when he was there. But all I know is Jackie Sherrill had that dog defense. Man, it's just like baseball. I don't care that they take steroids. Why? I don't want to see no boring game. Yeah, knock this home run out. If it wasn't for Sammy Sosa and Mark McGwire, I would have never watched baseball.
Yeah.
Remember when them two jokers going back and forth for about 3-4 years there, who the home run derby and Ken Griffey Jr. pop up and what's the other guy, the bald head black guy that they keep trying
Bonds.
To... Yeah, Barry Bonds. Yeah. I don't care if you take steroids, take it.
Yeah. Hey, just to add to that, I remember one time reading about, you know, Sapanola, like the high school up there in northern Mississippi.
Yeah.
That, you know, teams like that be ranked in the country instead of getting a player. I read that they would go out and pay these families to move, you know, like they go to Memphis to or something
and move down here,
get them a house and all that stuff. And it's the high school players, man.
Right. So my thing to all these other universities, y'all hate y'all didn't get Cam Newton, so something came out. Look, man, it's my talent. They need it. We trying to win. Any means necessary. Hey, these guys use some women to get them. And if you're a young young stud, you gonna take them women. That's just the bottom line, and you gonna take that money. And I'm not even on the wrong or right factor. I ain't gonna even lie. These young guys, they just think they trying to have fun. I'm just being real with you, man. Is it wrong morally? Yes, it's wrong. It's a sin against God to sleep around if you ain't married. But it ain't no sin to take no money. I don't care that you don't want me to take no money. Well, won't you take the place of me not taking the money? You feed me every day, and I won't need this money over here. I know you ain't offering that. So them other colleges basically just hating, man. Whoever brought this out hating. Bottom line, you need to go get you some fine women and find some money somewhere to pay you some blue chip All-Americans to come to your college. And maybe you'll win the national championship. People, this is Emanuel. We'll be back next week. Thanks.
This is Talk Radio 1580 WPMO.